This is a production of Cornell University.
First, I would like to say a few words about my home university, University of Helsinki, Finland. It has been established 1640, so it's quite old. There are about 25,000 students, so it's a little bit bigger than Cornell University, and about 8,000 staff members. So this is the main building of the university, right downtown in Helsinki. But the whole university is divided in four different campus areas in different parts of Helsinki area. And I work on Viikki campus, which looks more like this. So there is a research farm, and we are situated about 6 miles from downtown Helsinki. There's a research farm with almost 100 dairy cows. And in the pictures below, you see my research plots. We also offer international master's degree programs in agriculture. And I should mention here that university education is free in Finland. So the Finnish students don't pay any tuition fee, but the international students coming from outside European Union would have to pay tuition fee. So it's a really nice and green place in Helsinki to work at. So Finland is the most northern agricultural country in the world. We are situated as far north as Alaska, between 60 and 70 degrees of northern latitude. Helsinki is here, exactly as north as Anchorage in Alaska. And we have this 800-mile long borderline with Russia, and on the other side we have Sweden and Norway as neighbors. And there are 5.5 million people living on an area that is about 2.5 times as large as New York State. So it's really scarcely populated country. If you look at the map of the southern part of Finland, you see that there are plenty of water, a lot of lakes. There are anything between 200,000 of 500,000 lakes, depending on how you calculate which is the minimum size regarded to be a lake. And as there are so many lakes, almost every family has a cabin by the lake. So here are our girls sitting on the front porch of our sauna at our cabin, which is directly by the lake. So you can jump from the sauna to the lake swimming. And winter time this lake is frozen, of course, but then we have a ice saw and we cut a hole in the ice, and then you go swimming through that hole in the ice. Okay, so the major field crops that are grown in Finland are barley, wheat, oat, rye, rapeseed oil, sugar beet, potato, and caraway, which is produced for export, almost only for export. And these crops are grown mainly in the southern part of Finland, because up in the north, it's really the growing season is too short for growing anything. But actually, a lot of dairy farms are situated around this area here. And then for horticultural purposes, the country is divided into 8 hardiness zones. And for example, apples can only be grown here in zone 1. And most of the berry production is concentrated in this area, which is much colder than these coastal areas. But they also have a very thick and permanent snow cover during winter time, and that protects the overwintering berry plants from winter injury. So our light conditions are also really extraordinary. So in northern Finland at 70 degrees northern latitude. In midsummer, the sun doesn't set at all for a certain period of time. And then in winter time, there is 6 weeks period that the sun doesn't rise at all. In Helsinki, the changes in photo period are less dramatic, but still during summertime, it doesn't get really dark at all at night. And wintertime, the sun is always very low in horizon, so it's kind of dusk all the time, also during daytime. But many greenhouse crops, such as cucumbers, tomatoes, and lettuce, are cultivated year-round, and many herbs as well, in greenhouses using artificial light. And more the growers are starting to use LED lighting in the greenhouses. Here is an example of lettuce that is grown in hydroponics. And those lettuce plants are harvested with their small pots with a little bit of peat. And they are also sold like that. And that's why they keep very well. You can place that pot in a glass of water at home, for example. Then about berry production in Finland. There was recently a survey among berry growers, and they tell us that the average berry grower in Finland is 48 years old, and the most of them are planning to continue farming berries, and many of them are planning to buy more tunnels for growing their strawberries and raspberries. And the major concerns were the high cost for the places where you can set your cell booth. I will tell about this a little bit more later. And fake origin of berries, because what happens every spring, early in the season, when the price for the berries, for strawberries, especially, is very high, always somebody imports berries from Central Europe and puts them into these boxes which say Finnish berries and sells, and then they sell them as Finnish berries for a good price. And that may spoil the image of Finnish berries because the quality might not be very good. And the labor is also a big concern because now all the people working on berry farms come from either Russia, White Russia, Ukraine. And it's a lot of work for the growers during winter time to organize visas and working permits for all these people traveling to Finland for the growing season to work. And also the farmers have to make sure these people have a place to live, accommodate themselves, and a place to cook, and so on. But Finnish people are too spoiled to work on berry farms anymore. So strawberry is the most widely grown berry crop, followed by blackcurrant, redcurrant, whitecurrant, and raspberry. And then there is a little bit sea buckthorn, blueberry, and some aronia. Now I would like to share with you some management practices of each of these crops, and also very briefly to tell about the research we have done with each of these crops. Only June-bearing strawberry cultivars are grown in Finland. Polka is the most popular one because it has a very good tasting berries. The strawberries are usually grown on raised beds which are covered with black plastic mulch. They are drip irrigated, and acryl cover is used to protect them from winter injury. Strawberry planting stock comes mainly from Netherlands, Holland, either as tray plants like this one, which has a small pot of soil with it, or as bare root plants, which are graded according to their size, the biggest one being waiting bed plants, and then there are different size categories based on the diameter of the strawberry crown, and that tells how much yield this plant would produce after planting. And these plants are stored frozen in frigo storage, and then they are shipped to the farms, and when they are planted, they would produce a yield 60 days after planting, so that's why they are also called 60-day plants. In that way, the grower can predict what time he wants to have yield and adjust planting time accordingly. Plantalogica is a Dutch company that provides a very nice service to the people who grow strawberry plants. You can send your plants to this company. They will dissect them and count the flower initials inside the strawberry crown, and then you will get this kind of flower mapping report, which tells you how many flower trusses were there inside of the strawberry crown, at which developmental stage they were, and how much yield you can expect from this plant. So the plant, the one who sells the plants, can use this as a kind of guarantee that he can tell how much the plants will produce yield.
So Pauliina, that plant that was being analyzed by Plantalogia, that's seen as a model plant for all of the ones in
yes.
similar production?
Yes, it would be a sample of your from your production field. This kind of machine that can be used when before planting the strawberries, it would form the raised beds on the field, cover the bed with a black plastic, make the holes in a plastic, and then two guys could be sitting here and putting the plants inside the soil. So then it all can be done in one round, and there you see the newly planted strawberry field. And after a while, it would look like this then. Here is another picture of the strawberry farm by the lake. And he's a Finnish strawberry grower or berry grower. We studied together, and now he has this really nice big berry farm in southern Finland by the lake. So it's a really beautiful place. And he relies on pick your own in marketing, and therefore he also has a cafeteria on the farm and all kinds of other attractions that people would come there, spend time, pick berries, buy something at the cafeteria, and so on. So the popularity of the pick your own has gone down recently, but still there are some farms, pick your own farms, but then in addition to the berries to sell, you must have a cafeteria, nice transportation to the field, farm shop with several different nice products, some pets, animals for kids to look at, and some other attractions for the kids and the whole family. So people will not go there only for the berries, but also for entertaining and being close to the nature and so on. The berries in supermarket would be sold in these kind of small clamshells, just like here, but in the US. But a lot of berries also get sold in this kind of big boxes. They are 5 kilogram containers. And actually many grocery stores, they don't want to take berries for sale anymore because they are very perishable products. It's a lot of work to keep them good looking there. You have to every day check and throw the bad berries out. So what has happened recently, they just rent out the place for the grower to set up the booth and to sell his berries there. And this booth would usually be outside a huge grocery store by the parking place, or right there where you enter the grocery store in the hallway. And the prices for these places, the rent for them, they are extremely high, and there is a big competition for these places. So if you pay really much for the renting this place, you really also have to sell a lot of berries to cover the cost for that. But that's how it has turned out to be. And also there are marketplaces in almost every city in Finland or a town in Finland. There is a central square with a market, and a lot of berries, vegetables, plants are sold there. They are very popular places, especially in summertime. So the major problem in growing strawberries is gray mold, Botrytis cinerea. Now there is a way to control gray mold also biologically. It's a Gliocladium catenulatum fungus, which is applied as a powder, and you set powder here in front of the beehive, and when bees come out of their hive, they have to go through this powder, and they transport this powder in their fur to the flowers which they pollinate. And in that way, this fungus is distributed all around the field, and it has proven to be quite efficient in controlling gray mold. And it can then also be used in organic farming because it's a biological agent. Another problem that we encountered about 4 years ago is Phytophthora fragariae. And it was found in many Finnish strawberry fields during one very, very rainy summer. And they found out that it had come with the plants from the Netherlands, but now when it is there in the fields, you won't get rid of that. So you just, the growers have to learn to live with that disease. And strawberry is not a very cold-hardy plant. The strawberry crowns can only tolerate temperatures until minus 10 degrees Celsius. Otherwise, the growth will just decline, and at minus 12, minus 14, the crowns would die. And last year, we had, in January, there was almost no snow at all, and then the temperature dropped to minus 35 degrees Celsius. It's minus 31 Fahrenheit. And because there was no snow cover, there were really, really bad damages to many strawberry fields around Finland. And this is how these injured crowns would then look like. And after this major frost damage during winter, this last summer was very rainy. We got some rain almost every day. So there were really big problems with gray mold. So what happens now, more and more the growers are moving their strawberry plants into high tunnels, and they are cultivated in soilless cultivation usually, using peat bags like here. And this is a frigo plant, A+ plant coming from Netherlands, and when it is planted in this peat bag, after 2 weeks it will look like this, so it really starts to grow quickly, and in 60 days it will produce yield. Here are Sonata strawberry plants in peat bags, high tunnels, Eliani also in high tunnels, peat bags. Strawberry plants are also cultivated on tabletop cultivation, which makes it easier to pick them and do all kinds of management practices, and these nets are there to support the flower trusses when they grow, and when they are full of berries they are very heavy and they can break if there is no support for the berries. Some growers also use coco coir instead of peat in soilless cultivation. Some strawberries are also produced year-round in greenhouses, but the market for this kind of berries is quite limited. As there is a general trend in the Europe to get rid of peat in horticultural production, we have also studied different alternative growth substrates that could be used in cultivation. And here we tested reed canary grass straw and in growing strawberry, and we found out that the strawberries could manage just fine in this as long as water and nutrients are provided through drip irrigation system. They don't really care where their roots are. But there's a lot of research now going on and looking for these alternative substrates to substitute peat. So the second most important crops cultivated in Finland are black currants. And this is green currant, which is similar to black currant in taste, but it's not as tart as black currant. Red currants, red Dutch is the main cultivar, and white currants, white Dutch is the main cultivar. All these are have been traditionally cultivated for processing industry, not for fresh market. And this is how blackcurrant bush would look like. It's growing on raised bed also, and the row would be covered by black plastic or Mypex mulch. And then there's grass between the rows in the field. And this is a blackcurrant field in Norway. Looks pretty much similar. This is cultivar Ben Troon. And they are mechanically harvested. Jonas is a berry harvester manufactured in Finland, and it can be used to harvest different currant species and also blueberries and raspberries. And this is how black currants look like after harvest. They are mainly used for producing jam, juice, or wine. Blackcurrant really has a very good aroma. It's a very good tasting berry, I think. But because the price for processing berries has gone down quite a bit because of the cheap import from Poland, many of these berry farms that have produced berries for processing have had to find new ways to survive. And they have turned into wineries, berry wineries, and then they produce and sell berry wines on the farm. But then the price for blackcurrant in fresh market has more than doubled during last 10 years. And this is because people are more and more interested in healthy diets and consuming these healthy berries. And blackcurrant is extremely rich in antioxidants and many vitamins. So therefore, we have to find new varieties that can be grown for a fresh market, because our traditional varieties, like Öjebyn, is more suited for processing industry. So we are testing Scottish blackcurrant varieties that are bred for fresh market use. One possibility to produce currants for fresh market is this cordon draining system. There you harvest the currants as whole clusters, and you pack them in small clamshells. And the price can be much, much higher than for processing berries. And they also have a very, very long shelf life. And this is a special way of pruning and draining the bushes, so that they produce these long clusters filled with big berries. And we have examined this way of draining currants with white currant cultivars last summer, and it seemed to function fine. There on the right side you see the comparison of the berry cluster from the traditionally pruned bush, the upper one, and the lower one is from the bush that was drained using this cordon draining technique. Gooseberries are not commercially important. They are mainly grown in home gardens, but their popularity also seems to be increasing. So we will see if they become more important commercially. All these currant species are very easy to grow. They are very well suited to northern climate. But red raspberry is growing on its northern limit in Finland. But we grow floricane cultivars. We cannot grow primocane cultivars because our growing season is too short for that. And also raspberries are usually grown on raised beds covered with black plastic or Mypex mulch. And there is grass sown between the rows. There you see overwintering raspberry plants. And the cultivars which we grow in Finland, the major cultivars are Muskoka and Ottava, which are very, very old Canadian cultivars, which nobody else knows anymore even. But they are the only ones that are winter hardy enough in our conditions. But they are not very high yielding. The berries are quite small, although they are very good tasting. So now many of the growers have started with this Scottish cultivar, Glen Ample, which has very big, nice berries and is also very higher yielding. But the problem with Glen Ample is that two winters out of five, it would look like this in summer and spring. So all these overwintering canes that should produce crop this summer, they have died during winter time. Here is the Finnish cultivar Takalan Herkku, which seems to be doing just fine after this harsh winter. So many of the raspberry growers are also moving their plants into high tunnels, and that's mainly because of berry quality. Raspberries are extremely perishable fruit, but if they are grown in high tunnels where they are not exposed to rain, the fruit quality and shelf life are much, much better. They will not be infested with gray mold after harvest. Also, the yields are higher and the working conditions are much nicer inside the tunnel. So here are raspberries in the tunnel planted in soil and in substrate. And in Norway, they are also I think they are growing all of their raspberries in tunnels now, just because of the post-harvest quality and better shelf life. Long cane plants are used for production in high tunnels. These are 1-year-old canes where the flower initials are differentiated in these buds, and these are stored in freezing temperatures, just like the strawberry plants were, and kept dormant until they are planted in the field or in high tunnel or in greenhouse. And then they produce yield about 3 months after planting. And this is how a raspberry long cane plant would look like when it comes to the farm. And then it's planted in this kind of pot in coco coir usually. And water and nutrients are provided through drip irrigation. And here the plants are in high tunnel, starting to grow. You can also have more canes, like here are 4 canes in this kind of container. And here you see this white plastic net. It will provide support to the laterals. When the laterals start to grow out and they are heavy with berries, they would break without the support of this, provided by this net. This is just an example of coco coir bags that can be used for planting. This is a dry cake of coco, and then you just add water. It is ready in this plastic bag. You just add some water and then you plant your raspberries there. So this is a raspberry grower and he's explaining how happy he is with his raspberries growing in a tunnel now. He has 4 tunnels and 140 pickers picking his raspberries, Glen Ample raspberries, and he's happy with the quality and yield he's now getting. Most of the growers would buy new plants every year. So after planting these long cane plants in high tunnel and harvesting the yield, then they just compost the plants, and next spring they order new plants again from Netherlands or England, new plants coming to the farm and that way it's easier to handle pests and diseases, for example. So we in our studies we wanted to look if it is possible to control the growth of raspberry using a photoselective film, because raspberry grows very vigorously and it's a very vegetative plant. So we had raspberries growing in two tunnels covered with a clear film and then this photoselective film, and we found out that it was useful for controlling the growth of primocane raspberries, and also yield potential was increased, but it could not be used for growing primocanes of biennial raspberries because their flower development was impaired in this. But overall, the effects were not that big. We have also studied root frost hardiness in plants, because if the raspberry plants are overwintered like this, then the root systems are exposed to low temperatures, and the roots are usually more susceptible to cold than the canes, and they may get damaged. After an artificial freezing test, we found out that Glen Ample, the Scottish cultivar, suffered a lot of damage also at minus 10 degrees, whereas these hardy cultivars, Maurin Maca and Muskoka, they did fine until minus 18 degrees. So if the growers are using susceptible cultivars like Glen Ample, they should really pay attention for protecting them during winter time. We have also studied the effect of high tunnel conditions on berry quality, and especially the health-related bioactive substances in raspberry. We had three different cultivars growing in a tunnel and outside in the field. And of course, the yields were much higher inside the tunnel, almost double, and also much earlier in the tunnel than in the field. But most importantly, we found that berry bioactive substances like phenolic compounds and antioxidant activity, they were not affected by tunnel growing conditions. And the differences between the cultivars were much more pronounced than the differences caused by the different growing conditions. Now we are studying whether we could grow these primocane raspberry cultivars that are too late for our conditions, whether we could grow them as primocane plants in the tunnel. And we have seven different cultivars. We grew the canes in the tunnel. They were overwintered and then they were brought back to the tunnel again the next summer. And there is my student measuring the plants, a lot of plants to measure. So we wanted to produce the summer crop of these cultivars. And what we found out, the berry quality in some of these cultivars is just very good, but we are still analyzing the results to see if the timing of yield and the amount of yield is sufficient for production. Okay, now I have to skip some of the slides here. We grow some blueberries in Finland as well, but it's a rather new crop in Finland. It has only expanded recently when there are some of the Finnish cultivars have been produced by the breeding programs. But it has been a little bit difficult to market these berries because we also have this wild blueberry, Vaccinium myrtillus, and when marketing these berries, I think one should distinguish between our wild blueberry and these high bush blueberries. Because one thing I should mention is that we have the so-called everyman's right in Finland. I don't know how to translate that correctly, but it means that everybody has a right everywhere in Finland to go to the forest and harvest wild berries or mushrooms or whatever, regardless of whose forest it is, as long as you don't go to anybody's front yard or backyard. So people really harvest these wild blueberries in wild, and somehow it's difficult to understand why you should pay for buying your blueberries on the market. This is lingonberry. It is not cultivated. It's only grown in wild, and it grows everywhere in Finland. The average total yield is estimated to be 250 million kilos, and only about 10 to 20% of the total yield is harvested annually. And it is very easy to harvest. You use a handheld rake like this, and in a few hours you can have like 2 10-liter buckets full of berries. And it's also very easy to preserve because it's very high in benzoic acid. You don't have to cook it or anything. You just smash the berries, and then you can store it in refrigerator or in a cool place, and it keeps for a year at least very well. So we consume a lot of lingonberry jam. It's usually consumed with meat dishes. And this is a really Finnish specialty, Arctic bramble. It's a robust species. It's an indigenous plant in Finland. So it grows wild, and it has always been harvested from wild. But the places where this plant grows are getting scarce because there are less cows going on the pastures, and these were the places where this plant likes to grow and produce berries. So there have been efforts to cultivate this berry for a long, long time, but there have also been a lot of problems when you move a wild plant from the forest to a field where it's a monoculture conditions. A lot of problems usually then arise, diseases, pests, anything. But the berries are very expensive, and they are expensive because they are used for making this liquor, which is very popular and good, and this berry, it has a very distinctive aroma. You cannot mimic it anywhere. So the company who makes this liquor or jams, they really want to buy all the berries they can just get. And so this is how the Arctic bramble field would look like. Picking cost is also very high because the berries are quite small and the harvest season is long. So that's one of the problems. We have studied the biology of this plant, including flower induction, dormancy, and fruit set. And then we have also studied soilless cultivation. It's a very beautiful plant. We studied the possibility of improving fruit set in Arctic bramble by using biostimulants, and some of these products proved to be efficient in improving fruit set and fruit size. So we are continuing this research. These biostimulants can be used in organic growing as well. Now recently we have studied soilless cultivation of Arctic bramble using grow towers and different substrates, peat, coir, and sphagnum peat moss, and even wood shavings. This sphagnum peat moss is now, it's very popular to study that, and it has, it seems that it could very well be used as a substitute for peat, and it renews much more quickly in the nature than peat, so it's a more ecological alternative for that. Here are the Arctic bramble plants just recently planted in this grow tower, and this is how it looks after a while. It grows very vigorously. These are in high tunnel now. And this is cloudberry. This is a wild berry. It is not cultivated, but it's another robust species related to Arctic bramble and raspberry. And these are also quite expensive, but they are only harvested from wild. I just wanted to show you because it's a beautiful plant as well. Then we have wild cranberry species growing in Finland, but it's Vaccinium oxycoccus, and it is harvested from wild, but you see that these berries, they form and they are all almost inside this sphagnum. And usually it's very cold. This soil might be frozen when you pick them, and it's very tough work. So several people have tried to grow American cranberry species, Vaccinium macrocarpon, in Finland, but the efforts have not been very successful because our growing season is too short for your cranberry to be grown there. So we have taken a different approach, and we are now trying to grow American cranberry in high tunnels in these hanging baskets, and also using different growth substrate. So these are from last summer, these pictures. This is Pilgrim. We got, I think, 7 different cultivars from here, from the US, and they are now growing nicely there. We don't want to compete with the cranberry production here in the US, but the aim is more like produce a niche crop, very expensive healthy berries sold in small containers for the high price, because people are very much interested also in buying more and eating more cranberries in Finland. But we will see how this will work out. Okay, then I would just like to acknowledge the people I work with, several students at the University of Helsinki. Then I collaborate with the researchers at Natural Resource Institute Finland, LUKE, and researchers at the University of Eastern Finland as well. And some of my funding sources are mentioned here. So thank you very much. I'm happy to answer if you have any questions.
Yeah.
These two cultivars which I showed here, they are hybrids between North American gooseberry species, which are resistant to mildew, and between European gooseberry species,
which are not resistant
to powdery mildew. Yes?
Thank you for the presentation. In New York State, we don't do very much in blueberries.
Mm-hmm.
Why?
I don't think I'm the right person to answer that question.
No, but in Finland, you do with a little bit higher, a little bit colder weather. Why can't we do that in New York State with the blueberries? We do a lot in New Jersey, and Maine has a certain type of huckleberry. But for whatever reason, we don't do blueberries here.
I don't know. Maybe it's just tradition of growing some certain species.
Martin, can you answer that question?
Yeah.
So blueberries like an acid soil, and there's lots of acid soils in New Jersey and Michigan and places like that. We don't have sandy acid soils, but we still grow them. Probably more than you think, but it's just that it's not. And that we have to modify the soil with sulfur and lower the pH in order to grow them. So it's a little bit more work, but they do grow them.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
I have a question for you. So, In my mind, Finland is very much an environmentally conscious country. People are really, they want clean water and everything. And then now we're seeing all this plastic come into agriculture, which is sometimes seen as not very environmentally friendly to use plastic mulches and plastic tunnels and all stuff. What's the reaction of the public to more of this greenhouse and plastic and stuff in agriculture?
I don't think there has been a lot of discussion about it. This black plastic mulch on strawberry fields, they have been used forever, so nobody questions that. And now these high tunnels, it's a relatively new thing, but it's also that it's a big country, a lot of forest. The farms would usually be in the middle of the forest somewhere. Somehow people don't see that farm. It maybe it doesn't bother you, and But I thought about that when I was visiting Norway, and in Norway they really have these mountains areas, and you see really far, and somehow it's a very traditional landscape. And now they have a lot of these very tunnels, and then you have this nice view, open view, and then there is a huge concentration of plastic tunnels, and it really it did not look very good. But it's different in Finland. You are hidden in inside the forest, so yeah. But there really hasn't been a lot of discussion about that.
You've been distinguished between peat and sphagnum peat moss.
Mm.
And is the peat that you were mentioning, is that reed peat or sedge peat? You know, what would be the difference between that peat and the sphagnum peat?
The sphagnum peat is it's a plant that is still growing,
right.
And you harvest that. Right. I think it's called sphagnum.
It's
a growing plant. You harvest it and you dry it, and you can use that as a growth substrate. And peat that is traditionally used is this composted that has been composting in soil for thousands of years.
Yeah, because I would imagine that the peat that you're talking about is sphagnum peat. It's just
it is. Yeah, you are right. Yeah.
Deeper in the bog.
Yeah, you are right.
What is the length of the growing season in southern Finland?
It's about 180 days.
No, okay. Pauliina, thank you.
Thank you.
This has been a production of Cornell University on the web at cornell.edu.